JT, you want to come on over here this
way?
I would
love to.
Yay!
Good.
JT Eberhard, blogger extraordinaire. What is the name of your blog? It's What Would...
JT Do.
What Would JT Do? That's right.
Because I'm your real savior.
Talking about Apocalypse Now. So I'm going to let you take it away. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our final day. JT has it from here.
The day I get to take a microphone away from Jamila Bey, I've peaked at this point. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for dragging yourselves out of bed. I almost didn't drag myself out of bed this morning. Do me a favor, just to pump up my speakers to make my job easy, reach down to the bottom of your non-souls and give them the biggest ovation you can for this morning panel. I know you guys are tired. I'm going to rush through the bios so we can get into the panel. Two of our panelists I know, Teresa MacBain, needs no introduction to you all. She used to be a part of the Clergy Project, the Excommunications blog, was going to be a preacher, but decided to come over to the side of darkness, is now a member of the board of directors for American Atheists. A round of applause for Teresa MacBain. Sitting in the middle is Dana Fredsti, who is author of the Ashley Parker series with Titan Books. They are Plague Town, Plague Nation, Plague World. Her books are like a babushka doll. And she, for those nerds out there, she was also an extra in Army of Darkness. Round of applause for Dana Fredsti. Now, Tina Williams, I just met, and she provided me with her bio because I'm a professional. I'm going to read a little bit of it to you here. Tina M. Williams... has written Undead Winter, Sun Gate, The Apocalypse, The Melanie King Affair, Alice Hill and Silent Wonderland, and is currently working on future projects. She is also a freelance business journalist, copywriter, and business marketing consultant. Round of applause for Tina Williams. I did that as a joke earlier, and she said, no, 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 you have to read it that way. It's so funny. And I said, okay, as long as I can do it with a disclaimer that makes me look like not an asshole. Okay, so we've really thrown our protesters across the street a bone. Here we have a bunch of atheists at a post-apocalypse talk. Right up there, Allie. Writers, having talked with you this weekend, you're all extremely upbeat people, extremely smiley people, some of the happiest people I've met at this conference. Why post-apocalyptic fiction? Why does this speak to you?
Do you want us to go in any particular...
Yeah, whoever feels like going first.
Because one of the funnest things in the world is to destroy it.
And you just threw them another bone by applauding that line.
And I've had a cup of coffee.
Tina, why post-apocalyptic fiction?
Well, as my publisher says, it keeps the psycho at bay. That's why I do it, and this is why I'm happy. It's because all the darkness is in my books.
Romance writers are really kind of scary because they always have happily ever afters. We don't, so.
By the way, happy zombie day.
Teresa, has your time studying the Bible helped you to be more familiar with post-apocalyptic work?
Yeah, actually, very much so, I guess. And I've always been interested in that kind of the genre of writing. I mean, I don't know why it's so attractive, especially being a former minister, knowing the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel and looking for Jesus' imminent return, the destruction, and the tribulation. I guess it's kind of odd that a pastor would want to read about it in a different light. But I think so. And there is actually post-apocalyptic Christian literature, as JT said. It is the book of Revelation, if you'd like to read it at some point. And by the way, if you happen to see a number of people who have been suddenly vanish here and their clothes are left behind, you can just ask Kirk Cameron about what has happened in that situation.
We tried to get Kirk Cameron for this panel. He was busy making bad movies.
Yes, I believe that.
Okay, so you're all atheists, and in order to really succeed, you know, selling a media product, you have to manage your reputation. You need people to like you. How do you manage trying to appeal to people as an author and selling books with being public about a position that's frankly so unpopular?
I've mentioned this at our workshop on Thursday, and I've actually had people tell me you can't say that you're an atheist because you're going to lose your readers. And it's funny because the only people I hear this from are people within the industry, other authors and publishers. My readers really don't give a shit. They're like, we just want to read your work, and if they like it, they're going to keep reading it. They don't care what my background is. And I found that because I'm a little bit more open about who I am and I'm outspoken, it's encouraged other people, and I've actually had readers reach out to me and say, thank you for being outspoken and being respectful about it, and it's encouraged me to do the same. So it's only brought out good things for my readers, and I think they appreciate that. And, you know, I don't write happy stuff, so it's not like I'm attracting Christian-type people anyway. So, you know, the stuff I write is pretty dark, and, you know, I think most of my readers tend to be a little bit more open-minded anyway, so.
Dana, we'll toss this one to you. I happen to know for a fact that you are in cahoots with Kilt Kilpatrick, writer of...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, someone's familiar with their work. Writer of some of the best erotica in the entire world, and that you've contributed to some of this.
Actually, I got him started writing erotica. When we first started dating, we had a little present for each other. We would write erotic stories and give them back and forth, and I liked the one he wrote me so much I sent it to my publisher. So I got him started on his filthy, filthy path. And... yeah, we've actually edited an anthology together called Demon Lovers. We both have a story in there. And in his book, Under the Kilt, there's a novella called Blue Morpheus Inn, and that's actually co-written by the two of us. So I'm very proud to have been instrumental in starting him on that path. So, you know, I had nothing to do with the Jesus thing, but the dirty stuff, that was me.
Okay, so... what's it like switching between genres from horror to erotica? Is that something you kind of always wanted to do? Does writing one help you write the other in any way?
More coffee.
How do you get people out of bed in the morning? Talk about erotica.
Yeah, it's actually very easy to switch back and forth. And oddly enough, Plague Town was originally written for ravenous romance. I got a call from the editor there, and she wanted me to write Buffy the Vampire Slayer, but with zombies, but different. That was my entire direction with that. And I asked her how much sex she wanted to have in the book, because most of the stuff I've written for Ravenous, it's like, you know, they're actually called genre romance with lots of sex in them. It's not just the sex. There's a story attached. So she said as much or as little as I wanted. And so there actually is a sex scene in there that if I had been writing it, you know, for the next publisher, I probably would not have had it as graphic because it just wasn't necessary. So long-winded answer to that question, it's really easy to switch back and forth. You just go, this must have sex. This does not need sex. What will fit? And, you know, it's not that hard.
This one will go to all of you. Do we have any burgeoning writers in the audience? Anybody who wants to make it as a writer, considers themselves a writer? Okay, so a fair number of people. Where is the balance for you guys between writing for yourselves and writing for an audience? Do you write exclusively, like, this is the story I want to tell, and if nobody wants to read it, well, to hell with it, this is what I'm writing? Or do you ever stop and think, like, will this appeal to my writer base and write for them, and where is the balance there?
I strictly write for myself, and my readers just happen to like it. When I originally started writing, it was about 3 years ago. It was the first time I decided to start writing, and I have a background in business and marketing, and I wanted to write a story for just like a little blog post for my clients, something a little empowering, and then 4 months later I had a full-length science fiction novel. So apparently I had no idea that I wanted to be a writer, and, you know, make a long story short, I got published within that year. And I have not stopped writing since. I have 11 books out in the last 3 years and decided that this is something I can't stop doing. And one of the best advice I've ever received was write for yourself, because the minute you start writing to sell to somebody is the minute you start writing bad books. So all the books I've written are basically something that was the voices in my head that had to get out. And it's why I have a couple of different genres. It's literally, I wake up in the middle of the night and I have voices in my head and they're talking to me and they want to get out. And
oh, your rally is across the street then.
Except mine's really fiction.
Wow.
All right, Dana, why do you disagree?
I don't disagree at all. I'm just kind of scared of the voices in her head now because I'm sitting next to her.
I know. I'm glad I'm down here.
I actually do a combination of both. I've written since I was old enough to string words together, and I've always written things that I liked, including, okay, fine, Star Wars fan fiction, go on, whatever. For this, again, I was given an assignment, but I wouldn't have taken it if I hadn't been excited about it. And just to put this out there, I have liked zombies since way before they were cool. We're talking my first date movie was Dawn of the Dead back in 1980, so, you know, I figure that... I don't know why I feel obliged to say that, except everyone assumes if you're writing something that has zombies in it that you're jumping on the bandwagon to earn money, but that's, you know, not the case. I was actually passionate about the chance to get paid to write a fun zombie novel. So I combine the two. I've worked in the film industry, and I've done a couple of B-movie screenplays, and you have to be able to work with people giving you direction, going, I want that, I don't want that. My editor, who I call Dark Editorial Overlord, is very, very specific about certain things. And, you know, if you're going to write for certain publishers, you have to be willing to step back from what you want and do what they want you to do, as long as it doesn't take away from ultimately the book that you want to write. So you pick your battles and choose the things that are really important to you. And the more you write, and the more popular you get, the more you have a chance to just do what you want to do. And ultimately, I can have fun writing just about anything. So,
very good. Actually, I haven't written any apocalyptic kind of work, especially not any science fiction. But if you were in my talk yesterday, you heard me talk about how that confidence and acceptance and those things were stripped away growing up in a fundamentalist home. And an interesting aside or addition to that is that when I was younger, second, third, fourth grade, apparently I was a fairly decent young writer. I had a few teachers that were encouraging me to write a little bit more, and I enjoyed it a lot. However, that was not what God wanted me to do. So I moved away from that and worked in children's ministry. And, you know, if you've read my bio, you know, I moved all through the stages and finally became a pastor. So now that I'm here on the other side, this is actually 3 years since I came out publicly as an atheist. Thank you. Sorry, I spent too much time last night in a smoky bar voice this morning. I have been given the chance to write, and I'm writing for the Excommunications blog. I've written on JT's blog. Thank you very much for giving me that chance.
And it was my pleasure.
Thank you. So it's new for me. I'm working on a book, which at some point I will actually finish, and it will come out, and I'll let you know when that will be. But it's interesting. It's freeing. I still struggle with the lack of confidence and worrying that anybody will read it. But so again, long story to get to the answer. I really do write for myself in a way, but I also write for the people who are reading it at the same time. Most of my writing is based out of my own experience, and I think it's fairly transparent in regard to how my life has progressed and what's going on in my life and addressing current issues that especially non-believers face. In some ways, it's probably pastoral kind of writing because that's just the way that I'm built, and it's received a lot of good reviews and reports, and people say that they like it. So like you said, if people are reading it and people are enjoying it and it's appealing to what that they're man, it's 9:30 in the morning. I swear, I really did make a living by talking. You would not believe it today. My words are like floating around in my head. I think it's those voices that you were just talking about. They're all saying, no, say this, say that. No, don't say that. No, the word is actually no. It's spelled N-O. You know how to say this word. But I look forward to writing more in the future. I do enjoy it. I'm not disciplined, and I don't make time for it. It's probably one of the things I really need.
God wants you to write about zombies.
Okay, so write it down. Teresa, the name of her book is The New Zombie, Back from the Dead. A former pastor talks about her new life and eating people. And
yes.
Yeah, chainsaws and, yeah. Okay, so correct me on that. I'm not quite
I'm there
fully
for you.
Familiar with the
zombie. If you wanted to write a story about defeating a 2,000-year-old zombie, you got a
crowd.
Okay,
so I can be the zombie hunter.
You might have a niche market.
Can I be the zombie hunter? That would be just make me so happy. Okay, that would be, can I be in your next
you
book?
Can be in my next book.
Okay, excellent. I want to do that. That's you heard her say it on stage.
Okay, so for all the people wanting to get into writing, it's easy to look up here and see that you three are accomplished. You have readerships. You have the adulation of your fans, and I'm sure that looks very, very appealing to everybody. What are some of the challenges of being in your position that people might not know about?
You want to start?
Oh God.
9:30 panels.
What was the question? No, I'm kidding.
Just getting up early.
I don't know.
It's perfect. Life's great.
I think the biggest challenge for me is that once you become published is then making time for writing, because you're doing events like this and you're doing outreach and trying to reach readers and marketing your books and stuff. And I think just to keep writing and trying to bring out better books, because that's what your readers expect. They don't want to read a book, love it, and then go to the next book and not love it. They expect more. So you have to keep raising your own bar. And I think that's the most difficult part in working on your craft and stuff. So it's just juggling a lot of things. And, for me, it's being a mom and a wife and doing all the normal stuff that people do. And I don't know, you made it sound a lot more important than I feel like it is.
Exactly. I think for me, there's the double-edged sword of the internet, because you can reach far many more people, but if you don't have a thick skin, the trolls out there, there's going to be people that will read your work, and you can tell that maybe they read half of it, maybe not even that, and they just rip you to pieces, and they attack you personally. I mean, you all know that. My husband, who's the nicest man in the world, has people reviewing his nailed book and just saying these really hurtful things that make assumptions that he's writing books about biblical history to make money. You know? And this is just not the case. So for me, I hate getting bad reviews. I had to develop a very thick skin, and now I've gotten a lot better at it. That and also the time. I've worked a full-time job for the last 10 years, and we have 11 cats and a dog, and don't let my landlord hear how many cats we have. I hope she doesn't watch this stuff. And it really is challenging. And the third thing is what's called the imposter effect, where no matter how many books you write for me, there's always a point where I'm going, who am I feeling? I can't write. I can't finish this book. There's a lot of angst and stomping around and, crying and stuff like that. Maybe not quite that bad, but you really, for me at least, I undergo a lot of self-doubt doing each project, and I just have to keep, like the movie Ed Wood, it's just like, I've got to get through that door. That's every book, that's my mantra.
I think that premise might make even less sense than the Bible. I'm writing erotica, but to make money, I'm going to write history pointed at 10% of the population. I'm going to cut you guys off there, because I said I wanted to spend half the time doing audience questions. My clock says we have 8 minutes and 45 seconds left. My clock says we have 20 minutes left, so Jamila will cut me off whenever the spirit moves her. But I think we have a running mic, so I'd love to take audience questions for our panel. And while we're in transition there, how about another round of applause for these guys, not just for getting up this morning, but for being so wonderful. Where's our running mic? Okay, new plan. I'm gonna point to you if you have a question. You will yell it at me as much as your smoke-filled lungs from last night will allow, yes. And I'll repeat the question. Mr. Kilpatrick.
Hello.
All right, the books sound amazing. Can you give us a brief synopsis of all the books, starting with, let's start on the end with Teresa, since we gypped her at the end of that last section.
Gypped me. This is my book. Teresa needs to really work on it, and there is no title beyond the zombie.
Your book has no clothes on.
Oh, yes. This is my book. It is post-apocalyptic. It is actually post-Christian fiction. Actually, nonfiction. No, seriously. It will be not only my story of coming out, but it is a little different than a lot of the stories that have been written, because they were written so quickly after the person came out, whether they were a former pastor or just a former religious person or none of the above. Mine will have the addition of the 3 years post, oh, nice, am I going to pop those peas, after I had come out. So there is this vein of, yes, this is what happened in the past, yes, this is what happened at that time, and immediately following in the difficulty, but it will also have those 3 years following of the growth and the change and the positive aspects of my own personal life and my family life, but and some of the struggle and difficulty. So I'm really excited about it. I think it's not represented as much in atheism and in the world at large. And I hope that people will identify with it and will enjoy it. And by next AACon, I really need to have it finished so that I'm not holding up the back of someone else's book. Thank you.
Dana, tell us about your babushka dolls.
My babushka dolls, yes. As I said, the log line for this is Buffy meets The Walking Dead, which means strong female heroine, a lot of humor, zombies. The first book, Plague Town, it starts off in a small town, and on the back of the book it says, will they contain the zombie plague? Well, the next book is Plague Nation. What do you think? The most important thing about my books, and I'm going to say this because JT would not ask me a leading question, is that I use a lot of real people for inspiration in my novels, and our very own JT is a major character in the second and third book because he was visiting, he was running around like a mad thing, doing pull-ups and push-ups on trees and saying things like, is there a vet around? Because these pythons are sick, and stuff like that. And I knew I wanted to have a parkour expert in my series because if you're going to survive the zombie apocalypse, the ability to do free running seemed to me like, hell, you can get places no one else can. So JT made it in there, and I've actually gotten fan letters going, he's my favorite character, he's so dreamy. So
she has really good taste.
Sweet. And so I'm going to be in that book, right?
And she is
going to
be in my
this sexy
book.
Hot model with blonde hair. Yeah, and a zombie hunter. Okay. I want that. That's what I want for myself.
Okay.
My dream.
Yeah. Jamila, can you come take back over? I'm so embarrassed at this moment.
I told you I was going to do it. So.
It's 9:30 in the morning. We're just really, really, very punchy.
Yep.
I retire. I'm done.
Oh, no, JT.
You're
come
so dreamy.
Oh, my God. Tina, tell us about your books.
Unfortunately, JT is not in my books yet. But I might have an opera singer in there pretty soon.
I'm going to start charging you guys royalty just for having me in there.
Good luck.
I actually have an excerpts booklet. So if you guys, afterwards, when we're doing our book signings, I have a bunch of these that you guys can pick up. I'll just talk about the three up here. This one is my zombie book. So this is my apocalyptic zombie book. They're fast, manipulative, and conniving. And it actually stems from a nightmare that I had. So I wrote the nightmare down on Facebook, just a couple of paragraphs, and I had a bunch of people say, can you finish the story? And I said, I can't finish the story, it's a nightmare, I woke up. And they kept asking me to finish it. So I just said, okay, I'm just gonna do something really quick, wrote a short story, threw it up on Amazon, it became a bestseller, and decided, and got all these emails saying, please make it a full-length novel. So this became a full-length novel. This is Cluster's Case of the Missing. It's paranormal mystery, and it's inspired by real events of missing people in national forests, and this is my newest release. And then this one is Alice Hill in Silent Wonderland, and this one is just got commissioned to be turned into a film. I actually just got the contract 2 weeks ago. So to describe this one, thank you. This is Alice in Wonderland meets Silent Hill. Any Silent Hill fans out there, or Alice in Wonderland fans?
Wow.
Yeah, so this is a little bit on the darker side. It's illustrated on the inside. It's beautifully illustrated. I didn't do it. It was done by an artist, a fabulous artist in Arizona. And it's the first short story in my Twisted Fairy Tale series. And then I have a trilogy out that's based on Sumerian mythology. And it's a little bit on the interesting side because what I wanted to do with that one was, since Sumerian mythology, a lot of the Christian stories are very similar to Sumerian mythology, which I'm sure a lot of you guys are familiar with, I wrote this fiction story, and it kind of is a battle between the ancient aliens and the Vaticates. And it shows how their story is not original, and I've had a lot of people who, after reading it, Googled Sumerian mythology, and say, wow, this is actually true. It's not an original story. So it's kind of was my twisted way of sneaking in a little bit of information in there to get people to kind of realize that a lot of the Bible stuff is not original.
Tina, if you can give me a quick answer to this question. Oh, please. No, go nuts. I want to stick with the audience real quick, but I did have a question. You're an atheist. You clearly don't believe in the paranormal. Quick answer, is it difficult for you to write paranormal fiction, something you don't actually believe in?
It was really difficult to write clusters because it's paranormal mystery and it's real cases of missing people that have been unsolved. So the logical side of me kept trying to come up with a real answer of what happened, and there just wasn't an answer I could come up with. And so I went with the paranormal. Does that mean I believe it? No. It just means that it was what I wanted to do, and it's been quite interesting because a lot of my readers now believe it. So I apparently sprung up a new paranormal belief out there.
Oh, Dana, wow. You're giving me bedroom eyes.
I can't help that, JT, because you're so dreamy. I just want to add that because people ask, if you're an atheist, how can you write about stuff that isn't real, you know, gods, goddesses? How can you have people use, you know, when they're scared, go, oh, Jesus, you know, hey, that's how people talk, and I say it, and... But the thing is, it's like asking an actor, okay, we're fiction writers. No one goes up to an actor and goes, so you seem like a really nice person. Is it really hard to play a serial killer? No, it's fiction. It's acting. It's fiction. That's what we do. So,
yeah. Exactly.
All right. And Mr. Kilpatrick, thank you for acknowledging the questions. Do have a question mark. I appreciate that. Anybody else with a short speech disguised as a question?
No speech. How do you find a killer cover creator or whatever? I found some of those people very expensive.
Mine were commissioned by the publisher, so I just got lucky.
I actually have it written into my contract that I have a cover artist that I want to work with, who happens to be my husband's best friend, and he actually does all my book trailers and does movie trailers and stuff. And I've actually specifically requested that I have control over my covers, which is kind of unusual for an author. And so I like to have control over the covers because I always have a vision for them. It's the artist in me. And so that's the answer for that one.
That's a good answer because there isn't an artist within me.
Actually, I don't want to prejudice Rose further back than the first. Like. So I saw a question back here. Let's go get him. So I can see you all so easy. I'll get to you. But back here in the green shirt, farther back here, he's got his hand up. Stand up, yell, sing hallelujah.
Maybe people can come up to me. It'll be easier.
Oh, yeah. Well, you two meet halfway. It'll be nice and romantic.
That's a good idea. That's brilliant.
There she is. Okay.
Do you ever write something that when you first look at it, you think is really fantastic, and then you go back later and you think, oh, my God, this is a piece of crap?
Everything I write.
Yes, me too.
I thought my first short story I wrote when I was like 5 years old was epic, but, you know, it's... Yeah, we all have drawers full of things. Of course, now not drawers anymore. We all have computer files full of things that seemed like a really good idea at the time. So,
usually when you're writing something, you have to go back and edit it so many times that you do get to the point where you hate your books. You're like, I don't ever want to see this again. And I think as you progress through your career, craft develops, so you go back to some of the works you wrote before and cringe when, at least I do, I cringe when I read some of the stuff I wrote. But
you can always rewrite them. Yeah.
And that's what I'm doing with one of my books right now, is I'm actually rewriting one of my books because of that specific thing.
I see some confusion forming over whether we're going to have a line or be called upon. We'll go ahead with you this time, but let's wait to be called upon in the future. But you can go ahead and get this guy since he stood up.
Okay. And then maybe here.
This guy is grateful for that.
$20 after the show.
Jesus, I just gave my last $20 for a black...
So you have to ask a really good question then.
The question is, you just mentioned type files filled with computer files. Tell me about writing by hand versus writing by computer.
I used to write everything longhand, and now after working on a computer, for me, I used to do a lot better on the typewriter, because my handwriting sucks and I don't know what I wrote. I think I have really good ideas, and I'm sure I do, but I can't read them anymore. There was something about that sort of imperative hum of the typewriter that made the ideas just come faster. With a computer, it's just so much easier. I love it. I know other writers that just love writing longhand still, but they must have had better penmanship lessons than I did. So I love my computer, and I love my Alpha Neo Smart thing, which is a little word processor that doesn't have internet access, and you can only see three lines. So it really is helpful to turn off the desire to go back and correct everything you write as you do it. You just spew words out and go back and do it later. So,
as moderator, I'm actually going to cut it off there. My clock here says 2 minutes. My clock says 12, so I'm going to average it out and say we take 6 more minutes. Because I have real ultimate power. So quick questions, we're going to try and take 2 more. Yes, ma'am, right here, and then we'll go to the lady in the white shirt, please.
Am I allowed to make a comment about covers rather than a question in answer to that man? It's very quick.
I'm actually going to cut you off. This is a Q&A. I'm very, very sorry. I want to get to questions, though. The lady in the white shirt, please.
I have a question. I just want to say Iris Murdoch said in order to be a good writer, you have to be willing to kill your children. Which means your children are what you write. Okay.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that.
But my question is, how do you find a publisher when you're getting started? What did you do to find a publisher that fit your niche?
That's the million-dollar question. I lucked out. My first publisher actually heard of my story through a friend who was an editor and reached out to me and asked for the first few chapters of my book and then the full manuscript. And I signed a contract with her. I realized in hindsight that was not good because you don't want to go with the first person that offers you a contract. I since got the rights back to my book and I went with a new publisher I absolutely love who's local to where I am at. And I actually begged her to take me. So I don't recommend that route either. So it depends. Everybody, I think, has a different way. Yeah. The traditional way is to query out, get an agent, have an agent get your publisher. So it just depends on what you're looking for, if you're looking for a big publisher, a small publisher, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But I happened to find mine through networking.
I found Titan, excuse me, my voice, I've got the black lung here. The Ravenous Romance originally published Plague Town, and I got them because a friend of mine had written with one of their editors before. It was a brand new company. I sent them one of the short stories that I'd written for Dave, actually, and I got an in there, and I signed an 8-book contract. That's bad advice, too. Never do that, because it was really, really a bad contract, and don't let your excitement get in the way of common sense. But at any rate, the editor that asked me to write the first book thought that it would be better served with a larger publisher, and because it was a publishing house deal, they get half of my money for this particular set of books. So I got Titan, which is a really, really good publisher, via Ravenous Romance, and the trade-off was, again, I make half the amount of money I would make if I'd gotten it by myself or with an agent. So that was how I did it. I've also spent querying, publisher after publisher and agent after agent. And I also, self-publishing is, I think, a better option these days than it's ever been before, as long as your product is ready to go out there. Mm-hmm. So,
And I lucked out. I mean, I don't recommend this for everyone, but I stood on a stage at American Atheist Convention 2012 and came out as an atheist, being a pastor at the time, and was then interviewed at CNN and NPR and all the other standard media outlets and got an email from someone saying, hi, we're so-and-so and we would like to publish your book. And I was like, oh, really? I don't even know how this process works. I'm just a pastor and I have stalled and stalled and stalled for the last few years because, I'm afraid of the criticism like everyone else said and afraid that my own story and what I'm going to have to say won't be appealing or, just I think fighting the normal battles that anyone who is a writer struggles with, and I've heard both my panelists say the same thing, but I do think that each of us, especially that are contemplating writing books, those of you who are there out there and you are writers and you're looking for a way to get your story out there, that we all have something to say and that it's important. And even if it's difficult, which it is difficult, it's still worth pursuing that dream of getting your work published, getting your work out there, And the trick is just to find the way to connect with someone.
Networking is really important. When you know what genre you want to write, start going to conferences, join groups. If you write mysteries like Sisters in Crime, the World Horror Writers, writers are some of the most helpful, supportive mm-hmm. people you will ever meet in your life. And if you find ones that aren't just, you don't want to deal with them, but seriously, it's just like we're there to help each other.
I agree with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, time does fly when you're having fun, and ours is almost out, so I'm going to hold Dana to her assessment of writers. So if there are any other questions, I'm sure you can track these three writers down afterwards. They'll be more than happy to talk to you. Let's have...
We have a book signing.
What was that?
We have a book signing.
Yeah. Oh, they have a book signing. Go to the book signing, track them down, run them down. We have a few brief minutes here. Where can people find you guys online? Act as your own publicist and plug yourselves.
Wherever books are sold, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, you can go to my website for mine, theaccidentalwriter.com, and you can buy signed books there, or you can go to our bookstore right across the hallway, and we'll be signing the books right afterwards.
Same thing, and please feel free to friend me on Facebook. If you can't remember the last name Fredsti, I'm sure you can remember David Fitzgerald. Just go and look up his wife there and go find me. And I have not even close to neared my friend limit, unlike other people. Everyone loves Dave. So, I'm happy to answer questions online, too.
Yeah. And you can find me on Twitter at Teresa MacBain. Just look in the program. My husband is Scottish, so he's a Mac, not a Mick. He will definitely be correcting you on that. TeresaMacBain.com is my website. You can also find me on Facebook. Same thing, Facebook.com, Teresa MacBain. And I think that's, probably everywhere you can find me. And then, of course, after we're finished here, you can find me there. I will be happy to sign my fictional... It is. I'm actually a writer of fiction at this point. Yeah. Just imagine it. Use your imagination. Let the voices in your head tell you what it is. And
also, before we end, I don't want to speak for our panel, but I'm so grateful that you all drug yourselves out of bed and came out here at 9:30. How about we give them a standing ovation for coming out to see us?
Thank you, guys.
And you guys, thank you so much for coming out this morning. Have a great rest of the day. Jamila Bey.
And thank you, JT.
Yes, thank you.
On schedule, no worries.